The next panel is now going to focus on some of the issues, social, cultural, educational, and others that South Asian youth are facing and continue to face. Students and young adults form such a vital and such a critical component of the South Asian community, and I don't think they get nearly enough focus to voice their ideas, to share their experiences, their perspectives. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we create adequate time and space for them to do that. And so I was just very thrilled to have this opportunity to put this panel together, and which would focus exclusively on South Asian youth, because as you heard, they are the leaders of tomorrow, they are the politicians of tomorrow, and they are the human rights activists of tomorrow. So we just need to be more mindful of that and have them participate in larger conferences and forums like this. I have a very esteemed panel here consisting of young faculty and students, and I'm thrilled that they are able to be here. One of our panelists will focus on her experiences on teaching students in Bangladesh, but most of the other discussions will focus on South Asian youth in the United States. And so just to set the stage a bit, children of immigrant families seem to live in that neither slash nor world. It's a world which is neither fully the world of their parents' cultures, and nor is it fully the world of the culture that they're being raised in. It's somewhat that third space, which consists of an amalgamation of the values and the attitudes and the codes of conduct and the behaviors and the languages that are reflected from the other cultures that surround them. And so the predominant question that they live with is, who am I? And in trying to seek this, seek answers to this question, and trying to seek some sort of a cultural balance, they live with this constant negotiation of, or between the various dimensions of the various cultures that are surrounding them. And you know, they're constantly trying to understand where this cultural balance is, and what cultural elements from the environment do they catch? Because their environment changes so rapidly, one set of values and one set of attitudes and behaviors that are completely appropriate one moment may suddenly become inappropriate in another context the very next moment. And so this question persists: who am I, where do I fit, and what parts of culture do I hold on to? But to hear more about that, I'm going to turn it over to the panel, and we're going to start with Rifat Salam. And Rifat is instructor in the social science department at the Borough of Manhattan Community College and is currently completing her PhD in sociology at NYU. And the title of her presentation is Second Generation South Asian Americans, Ethnic Identity, Cultural Conflict, and Continuity. Yeah, and we're going to break the mold and just let him talk.
The presentation that I'm going to give you today is a little different from what I had originally planned, which was more academic and sociological. But given the time that I have, and to give more time to all of the wonderful people I'm sure will be listening to, I wanted to cut it down and change it around a little bit. Just to give you a little bit of a background, well, who are we talking about when we say second generation? For the purposes of my study, these are the children of 1965, which means that their parents immigrated to the US in that post-1965 through the 1970s. And it's a very specific kind of cohort. They're coming from middle to upper middle class backgrounds. Their parents were mostly professionals. And in point of fact, I'm very familiar with Professor Saran's work, and they're basically the children of the people that he studied. So they're a unique cohort, but I think that some of the things that I've learned from them, sometimes I'll say we and our, because I am from that generation as well, can still apply to future second generations or future cohorts. I'll tell you a little bit of a personal anecdote to kind of describe some of the experiences that people had. When I was a kid growing up in Brooklyn in the mid-70s, okay, It was a big deal to try to get them to understand that I was not a Native American Indian. And every year, you know, for the American history pageant, I had to be an Indian chief with the headdress. I kid you not. Usually there was some prettier, longer-haired Indo-Caribbean girl who got to be Pocahontas, but not me. So we grew up with a lot of these confusions. We had this double identity of having to be Indian, Bangladeshi, Pakistani, in Nepalese, whatever, you know, at home, and having to be American at school and in the outside world. So there is this double life that we talked about. So here are some of the things that I have observed. Well, first let me talk about how the rest of the world sees us, okay. So there have been a lot of attention, like, you know, Newsweek, all of these different publications that talks about the second generation and arranged marriage, and they all, you know, marry people they know. And this is something that a lot of people are concerned about, because arranged marriage is interesting. It's exotic. You know, it's everybody wants to know about it. People have constantly asked me about my own arranged marriage, which didn't really happen. So it formed like kind of the crux of my research project, because what I wanted to get to was how dating and the ideas or choices around marriage tell us about this generation becoming American. And so I'm going to frame this in terms of the dilemmas, okay? Here are the dilemmas that the second generation has faced, and I think this applies to every second generation, but particularly it's acute for South Asian, because so many of our cultural norms, like arranged marriage, like norms around you know, gender and gender expectations, are so in conflict with mainstream American cultural values. So these are things that are especially highlighted. The really at the heart of it is the choice between personal fulfillment and individual autonomy, what we want as individuals, versus family duty, our loyalty to our families, and our loyalty to our ethnic communities. Okay? And a lot of us make the choice seem really easy. You know, we are the image of the second generation Indians especially, but South Asians in general, are, you know, pretty much look like the fulfillment of the model minority dream, right? We're successful, a lot of us, and the ones that aren't are not visible, okay? We are, you know, excelling in finance, academics, medicine, engineering, you name it, right? But at the same time, we have a lot of personal life choices that we're making that involve a lot of compromise, negotiation, and sometimes even heartache, right? And some of you, you know, I'm sure have experienced that and can talk about that. So at the heart of it is this tension between the ethnic community and the family and individual autonomy. And where does it fall? The image of the second generation is that basically they're very good and listen to their parents. And eventually they'll do what their parents want. And it may look like that. They may look like they're having arranged marriages, but what I found in my research is that nobody really has quote unquote traditional arranged marriages. Even those who look traditional, you know, probably one of the big categories that I found, they are dating, they're being set up on blind dates, but not actually having what's called quote unquote arranged marriages. They believe that marrying someone of their same background will make them happier, and they feel that that is an individual choice that they made, and it's great that their parents are happy about it as well. The second category of people that I found in terms of their life choices is that they really are open. And this, you know, to whomever they might choose to marry. And their dating lives were very much veering away from traditional South Asian, you know, courtship norms, let's say. And they are opening to marrying someone of the same background or not, right? And they're the ones that have to make more compromises and negotiations with their families. Underlying all of this for the second generation is this fear of being rejected by their ethnic community and their family, right? We don't necessarily talk about it, but we whisper about people whose parents kicked them out or, you know, cut them off or, you know, disowned them, right? So a lot of us have this fear as we make our life choices. But here's the thing, a lot of parents are very flexible and negotiate as well, which is you know, for some people is unexpected, because there's this idea that there's this tradition that you can't break. So there's negotiation and compromise on both sides when talking about intergenerational relationships. So, you know, what does this mean for us? It means that on the micro level, the experiences of the second generation are a lot more complicated than they do everything they're supposed to. Or they're really not fully American because they keep to themselves, right? That's a stereotype that people have of South Asians. They're very successful, but they keep to themselves, right? And I think that those attitudes marginalize and exoticize the South Asian communities and stand as a barrier to full participation in American society. And what I hope is, in recognizing the negotiations and compromises and the struggles that the second generation faces, we'll see that their experiences are not so different from prior second generations of immigrants to the United States, and that they are on the road, if not already there, to full participation in American society.
Thank you, Rifat. The next speaker is Samina Shahidi, who is adjunct lecturer in English and Composition at Lehman College. And she is currently pursuing a doctorate at the City University of New York in Composition Rhetoric, Postcolonial Literature, and Women's Studies. The title of her presentation is Writing from Third Spaces, Student Negotiations of Ideology, Gender, and Literacy.
I wanted to thank Amita for this wonderful panel, and Ari also for putting on this conference. It's an honor to be here. Well, I teach at Lehman College, which is a predominantly working class and of color school in the Bronx, and working there has afforded me amazing opportunities to talk to Muslim South Asian students as they are working towards education, working towards their educational goals. And, you know, I was thinking about some of the students in my classes and some of the Muslim students at Lehman College and in the classes of my colleagues, and also thinking about the kind of time we live in. It's such an ideologically fraught time, especially if you're a Muslim. And also, that part of this language of ideology that's taking place is this language that categorizes Muslim women. And I guess one example would be just when we, you know, when you think of, if you in your mind's eye think of what a Muslim woman looks like, you know, you might have an idea that, you know, is, maybe he sees her looking a certain way, one way, you know, hijabed or, you know, very quiet or not really taking part in her education, not taking part in her political systems. And so these are the kinds of images, I think, that are part of the vocabulary that takes place even in classrooms. And so I thought, well, what would it be like what is it like for a young Muslim undergraduate woman to negotiate that kind of ideology in the classroom? How does she deal with the kinds of issues at home? How does she try to make her way? How does she negotiate the kinds of issues she has to in this culture? And then also find her own voice. Basically, I'm looking at this particular issue through the frameworks of composition rhetoric, which is my field. Composition rhetoric is quite briefly the study of knowledge making through writing and literacy. And so I thought I would use three frameworks that are being discussed either in composition rhetoric or, believe it or not, literary theory, there's a use for it, to see how these young students actually get through their educations. So the first framework that I'd like to talk about is the contact zone. And it's basically a framework of looking at the classroom in terms of the kinds of values and assumptions about values that are made in the classroom when students are being educated. You know, the kinds of textbooks that you're given, the kinds of discourses that take place, the kinds of assumptions or values that are taken for granted. And the contact zone is basically a way of looking at what happens in our classrooms, what kinds of texts we assign, and what are the results of these texts on our students. How do our students kind of, you know, what happens when, let's say, you walk into a classroom and, you know, you're given a textbook that shows the community that you're a part of in one representation. And that representation may not be what your representation is, or it may not speak for all of the different kinds of, you know, identities that exist. And so, you know, this idea of the contact zone is that the classroom is a place where there's a lot of marginalization that takes place. And I'm going to give you a definition by the theorist Mary Louise Pratt, who came up with this framework. And hopefully that this will kind of anchor this idea. The contact zone, well, we use this term, writes Mary Louise Pratt, to refer to social spaces where cultures meet, clash, and grapple with each other, often in context of highly asymmetrical relations of power, such as colonialism, slavery, or their aftermaths as they are lived out in many parts of the world today. Eventually, Pratt will use this term to reconsider the models of community that many of us rely on in teaching and theorizing and that are under challenge today. So basically, Pratt's theory underscores several unarticulated dynamics that take place in the classroom. The first one is that writing or literacy automatically unites participants in a shared community. We all speak the same language. We all have the same values. You know, we all work on the same assumptions. We all are going the same places. We want to go to the same places. B, that the language of the community is similarly shared or a device of constructing a world of uniform mores and worldviews. And finally, the idea of what Pratt terms a universally shared literacy, that there's a single conception of what literacy is, how it's constructed, how it works, and what it achieves. For example, this idea of a universally shared literacy could mean the Western canon. Right, that the Western canon itself, if you know the great books of the Western canon, you are literate. So having taken into account this criterion, Pratt argues is the essential construction of the classroom. We're left with the conclusion that the unexamined classroom is based on several kinds of exclusions. So how, my question, you know, several questions came up for me as I was, you know, kind of thinking about this theory and then thinking about how my classroom and teaching and how students experience the classroom. I also thought about, well, how does a classroom become a site of unquestioned representation, particularly in the case of Muslim women? And so I'd like to illustrate this idea with the case of a Pakistani-American student I interviewed, and her name is Sarah Bhatt, and Sarah Bhatt gave her permission for this presentation. Sarah Bhatt is of Pakistani descent. Her family moved to the United Arab Emirates, and then they moved here. She wants to become an English as a second language teacher. She's fluent and literate in Urdu. Here are some of the issues that she's going to have to deal with. She has a limited number of years before her parents are in school, before her parents will ask her to get married. So right now, she's taking as many courses as she can. She's really loading up on the credits so that she can get her master's. That's her goal. She's asking herself questions about what will happen to her degree after she gets married. She wants to continue to teach, but she's getting the impression that, you know, after she does get married, teaching may not be a priority in her household. So she's at this place, right, where she's got to think about what she's really focusing on. Her coping mechanism right now is to just try to get through school. A couple of other factors: her mom her mother's side didn't attend college. Her father's side has, so there's kind of this, you know, these two different experiences with college in her family. And she's often silent in her classes because she's self-conscious of her ESL skills. And so, you know, when she's faced with, let's say, a representation of a Muslim woman in a class that she finds one-dimensional or maybe one, she doesn't say anything. She gives me an example of being in a sociology class and watching a film called Passages of Life, where the discussion of Muslim women basically was represented by an image of a Muslim woman who was covered, and a voiceover said, "And the Muslim woman's wife will, the Muslim woman's family will choose her husband," and that was it. It was just kind of that whole discourse was just, you know, kind of collapsed into that moment, and there wasn't any. That was it. There was no other discussion about it. So, and she's quiet during these discussions. So, you know, that's something to think about. The second thing I wanted to bring up was this idea of how students negotiate ideology and language. And the framework that I was using to think about that was one proposed by Minjian Lu, who's a Chinese-American composition rhetoric theorist, and wrote very profoundly about how language symbolizes ideology, and how, and writes about how, as a child in China during the communist, during communism, had to kind of practice two kinds of languages. The first one was this Chinese communism, or this language of the communist ideology of China, and then this liberal arts language that her family was trying to teach her at home. And so for her, it's a kind of code switching, right? You move from one code to another. And for her, this kind of code switching was very confusing for her. I mean, she at point, she kind of was trying to figure out, well, you know, what if I lose my language? There was this conflict in terms of her moving from thinking about who she was in one sphere and moving about, you know, a conflict over who she was in another sphere. So I thought that was an interesting thing to look at. And one person that does this or has talked about doing this is Nusrat Chaudhry, who's a Bangladeshi-American student at Lehman College. Nusrat is also another interesting person to think about. She's first-year honor roll student. She's a math major. She attended private school, and being in private school as a high school student, she was aware of many class issues. And so basically, she sees herself as someone who is constantly arguing the other side. When she's in Bangladesh, she argues on the side of being an American. When she's in America, she's always arguing on the side of her Muslim identifications. But so, you know, these are some of the kinds of ways that these students are kind of dealing with what they do in the classroom. I wanted to thank. Thanks.
Thank you, Samina. And I know there's so much that we want to share. Please feel free to continue the conversations over lunch and over breaks and, you know, throughout the day. But Rifat and Samina, by sharing their research, really nicely framed the stage for the next speakers, who are actually going to talk about their personal experiences and share their narratives of how they grappled with specific issues. And to start off, our students here is Sohana Barot, who's an undergrad student in the Department of Political Science at the City College of New York. Sohana will share her experiences of growing up Indian in the US and the challenges of grappling with issues on self-identity.
I am, well, almost 19 years old. I was born in Tarrytown, New York, and I'm first generation American. My parents were born in India, grew up in India. My a very, very traditional culture. So they had very traditional ideals. When I was growing up, I was faced with three scenarios of what kind of person I would be. I was faced with, okay, I could be too Indian, or completely Indian, in America and not fit in at all with Americans. I could be too Indian. I could be too American and not fit in with Indian culture, completely dissolving my heritage. And then I could be a happy medium. I would be a little bit of Indian, a little bit American, but I still wouldn't fit in with the American culture. I still wouldn't fit in with the Indian culture. When I was growing up, it was in my house we learned Gujarati. I learned how to speak it. I could speak it very well when I was very little. Whenever I went to India, I was with my cousins, and I spoke it sometimes, and I had an American accent. They did not like it at all. They teased me mercilessly on it. My aunt and uncles thought it was so adorable, and I did not like that at all as well. So I was very turned off to speaking Gujarati to begin with. Because of that, I just stopped using it over a while, and it just left my mind. When I was little, I also did not like wearing salwar kameez. I wore American clothing all the time that I was so used to wearing American clothing, I didn't really like the change of wearing something so traditional. So I also was too embarrassed to wear those, even when I was in India. When I was growing up in America, when I was not visiting India, I had probably one or two close Indian friends. And this was in Rockland County, so we didn't really act Indian when I was with them. We acted just basically borderline. We acted Indian, we acted American. It was our own little culture. I was not very close with them as well. So there was no real basis of an Indian community where now I was growing up. I was actually kind of scared of the Indian community. We did have Indian Culture Society of America, Indian Culture Society of Rockland County. I used to go to their functions and their dances, and I'd see all these people wearing Indian garb and saris and salwar kameez, and they were all speaking all these different languages, and I was scared of them. They're too Indian for me, and I just was wanting to fit in with something, and right now it was just American culture was beckoning to me just because I was growing up that way. Right now I have, in college, I have Indian friends. They don't quite believe that I'm Indian, though. When they first met me, they thought I was Hispanic, Sicilian. I didn't act Indian, I didn't speak with an accent, I basically acted American. I was actually called white once by one of my friends. I find that disheartening because I'm very interested in Indian culture. I just recently restarted learning Gujarati with my American accent. I won't say any words to you now because I had enough laughter to begin with. So I like wearing kurtis, what I'm wearing right now. I like wearing salwar kameez. I just can't feel comfortable wearing it in New York, though. Like, if I went outside in a traditional salwar kameez, I would feel so unsure of myself because it's out of the norm. And I consider myself American as well as Indian. I speak like an American. And so to have that kind of impression of Americans looking at me that way as too Indian, it shocks me a little bit. So, in other words, how I grew up, I kind of became a little bit too conservative for American culture and too wild for Indian culture. A funny little story, when I was in India with my cousins and I started whistling, and my male cousins were just like, don't whistle, snakes will come and get you. And then my cousin was on a bike and I was starting to run beside her. And she's like, don't run, it's not ladylike. So yeah, it was pretty interesting. I also found it interesting that I was stronger than a lot of my male cousins. I was on a canoeing team. So I was very tomboyish for them, even though I am girly for American standards. With Indian culture, it's kind of stereotypical to go into the sciences and mathematics. I was biochemistry my first semester at college. I am currently in my second semester of college, now political science major. completely threw away the sciences and became a political science major. When I told my parents, they freaked out, to put it in the right terms. They were like, you're not gonna make money, and then they were like, okay, fine, you might make some money. And they started doing all this research, and I'm actually kind of lucky in how I grew up because of my sister. She's older than me by 7 years. She paved the road for me. My parents are very lenient with me now, and a lot more lenient than they are with my sister, who's still fighting with them on many aspects of getting her freedom. But in general, I do consider myself an ABCD. American-born confused AC, and that's all I am.
Thank you, Sohana, and I'm sure Sohana's stories will resonate with a lot of you sitting here in this audience and certainly sound familiar. For our next speaker, we have Rimaz Hussain, who is an undergrad student in the Department of Physics Education at the City College of New York. And Rimaz will share his experiences with school expectations and academic work, having arrived in the U.S. as a high school student from Sri Lanka.
Good afternoon, I believe. Yes. Thank you. I arrived here about 5 years ago, and I was born in Sri Lanka, Colombo, and I was educated at an English medium school. So when I arrived here, I was able to speak English already, but the common perception is that if you're an immigrant, you can't speak English. And when I open my mouth and when I start speaking, people always tell me that, oh, you caught up with the language very fast. And I'm like, no, I started with English. It wasn't my first language. It was a mixture of language. I'm trilingual, so I was brought up with three languages. I do not know which one of them is my main language. So that is, in a way, my my identity, which but when you stop speaking some of the languages, like when I'm in America, I don't get to speak Tamil, which I believe some of you probably know how to speak. But if I do start speaking Tamil, I start to realize that I've forgotten so much. But that's my transition into America. And talking about education, back in Sri Lanka, they used the British system of education, so you had to take your O-levels, A-levels, and the exams were tough. The classes were really, really tough. And coming to America, they expected me to, as I said, not speak English as well. So they tended to put me into classes that were easier. Regents classes. They did not put me into ESL classes, so I escaped from that. But they did put me into Regents classes, and I had to work my way through into honors and into AP. So by 12th grade, I ended up taking most of the AP classes. What else? Yes. Being a Muslim. Being a, especially at a time of today's world, it was kind of hard. Especially being an immigrant, most of the people in this panel are first generation, and I'm not. I'm still not a citizen or resident. I'm still an immigrant. So it also plays into my college life and my and my identity. Yes. But overall, the transition from Sri Lankan education to American standards was not that hard for me. It was very easy. I got through classes very easy. But getting into college was a whole different story. I'm having trouble with my science classes, which some of my Indian friends, well, I have a lot of Indian friends. I was talking to one of my friends yesterday, and I told her that I'm having a problem with Chem 104. And she was like, you're brown, you shouldn't have a problem. I'm like, what's that supposed to mean? So it becomes a stereotype, not only in the eyes of an American, but in the Indian culture, in the South Asian culture too. So which kind of upsets me in a way, because I love physics. That's why I'm doing that's why it's my major, and I love education. So I'm getting into education. But on the other hand, my love is in photography. I love taking pictures, but my parents are not going to understand if I told them I want to do photography or filmmaking. They'll be like, what? what are you talking about? And mostly my mom would probably do that. But it's hard. And while I've chosen to take this path through college, things might change. And I hope it does, in a way. Thank you.
Thank you, Rimaz. And next is Ruma Chowdhury, who is a doctoral student in TESOL at Columbia University. And Ruma will speak about the perceptions of South Asians as second language English speakers and the reactions of students in Bangladesh to taking the TOEFL exams. And Ruma is also a representative of the SAVE organization, which is the South Asian Voices in Education, a student organization at Teachers College, Columbia University.
Just taking up on the theme introduced by Ramiz, that that South Asians who come to this country are labeled as second language speakers because they speak a different variety of English. I'm just going to speak about international students who come to the U.S. for higher studies. It just said, when you come here, one of the things that you're required to do is to take the test, which is known as TOEFL, Test of English as a Foreign Language, regardless of your proficiency in that language. Most countries in South Asia, they have English either as an official language or a foreign language or a second language. And many children actually grow up with English as their second or first language. Many of them speak it as native speakers. However, when they apply to come to the U.S., they have to take that test. When I first applied here, because I have a degree, a bachelor's degree in English, and I also taught English back home in Bangladesh, I automatically assumed that I wouldn't be taking this test. So I wrote to schools here saying, can I be exempted? So the response was, no, you don't come from an English-speaking country, therefore you have to take it. So this is the experience that many international students coming from the region face. So what does that mean? I mean, I regard this label, second language speaker, with mixed feelings, because I do consider English to be part of my identity. It is my language. Yes, it exists alongside my other languages, but it is there. So when someone gives it a different label, automatically I question my identity. So am I not an authority on that language anymore? Is it someone else's language? And of course, a lot of my fellow friends who are here studying, they mentioned that because their accent is different, so their variety is again seen as something alien. And they talk about how their sentences are considered flowery, and some of them, as he has mentioned, like you get comments, say, oh, you speak good English, as if you picked up the language here, but you have done that back home. So how do you regard this test then? It becomes an irritant for people who think that they know the language, but they still have to take it. Also, TOEFL doesn't really measure the kind of proficiency required in academic settings here. So it's not testing what is meant to test as it is. So naturally, there's a level of frustration attached to that. And I've just spoken to some people earlier, right before the panel started, and they said even here, even if you studied here in secondary schools, like high school, you're still required to take TOEFL, and which is strange because they speak English as a first language. So now I'm just going to talk a little bit about students who I meet back home in Bangladesh who want to come here. Some of the students have low proficiency in the language, and they then regard TOEFL as a barrier to coming here. They know their subject matters really well, and they score high in those tests. However, because their proficiency is low, they don't score very high on TOEFL. As a result, they cannot come here, so the transition isn't there for them. When I go home, so they ask me how to prepare for this test. They find the American accent difficult to follow because you have a listening component to the test, and they're not familiar with the idioms that are used here. Also, they have trouble with the spoken component as well. They're saying that they're taped and they get low score because the people who are scoring them sometimes don't understand their accent. So these are issues that I have with the test TOEFL and how it could be either a barrier or irritant depending on your level of proficiency in that language.
Thank you, Ruma. And now we have, we're back to our panel of faculty now. And Niloufar Haque is Assistant Professor of Physical and Biological Sciences at the New York City College of Technology. And based on interviews and her conversations with young South Asians, Niloufar will present a firsthand analysis of growing pains that they have experienced, confronted, and have had to overcome in their daily lives.
Good afternoon. Please bear with my laryngitis because I have a problem. So if I start choking, that's because I need to take a pause. I am at an advantage. I suppose that since morning that I have been listening to the different speakers, I feel that I'm at an advantage because all the issues that we say as minority, I have a number of minorities to my credit. I come from Southeast Asia, third world country, India, and I'm a Muslim. And being a woman, that puts me in a special category. I was brought up in the British system of education, so I never had a problem with language. In fact, I ended up being more fluent in English than in my own mother tongue, though I speak a number of different languages. I was sent to British schools because that was an opportunity my parents thought which would put me in a league above others. It was not easy. We were five of us, and the parents had really had to put up a lot of effort to bring us to that level. I never realized it at the time, but I do it now. Towards my O levels, my parents started thinking that I was getting too British with fundamental ideas about freedom, women's independence, etc., and they packed me up to a minority institution, which is the Aligarh Muslim University, which is the biggest residential university of the country. It is one of the Ivy League universities, five Ivy League universities in my country. And my father was thrilled when he was leaving me at the gates of the hostel because it had big high-rise walls. Since I was in school, most of the time it was jeans and sneakers at off-school times. The special occasions, yes, we dressed up. Eid, Bakrid, any festival. We had traditional dresses with all the trinkets attached. It was fun then. We looked forward to it. because it meant, festival meant a lot of celebration, free time, no homework. And the parents being happy with us because we were good kids. At Aligarh, I learned that being isolated in a culture does not necessarily mean that you cannot progress. The progress depends on an individual's endeavors. We go as far in life as we endeavor. There's no limit. We set the limits. We find excuses that I cannot do it because there can be any monochrome attached to it. I never thought as I was growing up that anything was impossible. If something my brother could do, I felt I could do it better, and I usually did. After my education, when I came abroad, because there was nothing like you could say that you did not have a choice of the subjects that I wanted to be a journalist as I was growing up. My father said, no way, you'll become a filmy journalist, you'll go around all those magazines, you get your master's, you go into medicine, study science, and then become a National Geographic journalist. I did not dare, I was the oldest, so I did not dare to defy. So I went into science. I pleased them, and also because science meant that the child is studying science, social status of the parent goes up. They have smart kids. It has nothing to do so much with security. It's more in terms of the intellectual capacity. It is believed that if your child studies science, he or she is smart and will be able to make it. It's different that medicine means you can be independent. You are not dependent on someone for your security, for your earnings, for your financial security. So I studied science and I became a neuroscientist. 12 years in research, I was cooped up in labs where I was there before sunrise, and most of the times when I walked out, and by the changing seasons, I would only know when the snow was overlying or the leaves were falling, because I would not see the daylight, and I did not have an idea what was the weather outside, what was the season, and years rolled by. When I came to America, I was thinking that there are so many things growing up with the parents when I discussed, I felt that they did this because I was a girl. You were supposed to dress up a certain way. You had to wear your scarf, the dupatta. Sometimes it was difficult. Why should I wear a dupatta on a bell-bottom or t-shirt? Neighbors are visiting. What would they think? My father liked to hang around in the kitchen, and my mother was always upset. What would the neighbors say? You have two grown-up daughters, and you are in the kitchen. Your girls are no good. They don't know how to take care of the homes. When I was coming abroad, I got the job while I was still doing my PhD. I was one of the first girls to come abroad on a job from my university. Most of the girls came abroad because they got married to someone who was overseas. So when the telegram came with the appointment letter, the provost and the warden opened it thinking that it may have some bad news. Everybody knew before me that I had been offered a particular job. And I'd even calculated in terms of the foreign currency how much I was going to earn. I had no idea. So I spent about 4 years in Africa, and I loved to travel, and I think that was the basis of the education that I have had, learning about different people under within their own circumstances and knowing them better and making me more tolerant to many of the idiosyncrasies that I have. Coming to America, I thought sky is the limit. But when I came here, I found there were limitations here too. Not just as a Southeast Asian, as some of the panelists said, in terms of language, people speak to me. It doesn't matter what post, what position. And they say, you speak very good English. How long have you been here? No matter what I tell, I can see that expression in their eye. They don't really believe I could have had that kind of background from before. They would often say, this is the place for you. You can progress. You won't have the hesitation. As a Muslim woman back in country, you'll have the restrictions. Your parents will choose things for you. I cannot, still, I try in my own way to tell them that it's not so. Yes, there are restrictions there. There are restrictions here. It's a social system, which has nothing to do with religion. It's a cultural identity to which we stick to hang on more for our own security, because we look different, we feel different. The difference should enrich a system, not make it poorer. Over here, after I came back into the academia in the last 2-3 years that I've been teaching, I have had the opportunity of meeting many of the younger people. Sometimes it's very frustrating, especially when you're teaching sciences and anatomy and physiology, and I find a student from human resources sitting in that class, very frustrated, and I'm wondering why he or she is there. The professors advised that was the only course available. No proper guidance. There are many scholarships here in the colleges for minority students. Minority meaning African-American, Hispanic, or Indian-Americans. After the 65 abolition of the national origin restrictions on immigration, at the time, there were about 15,000 immigrants. By 1980, the number rose to 500,000. And as you are all aware, by the boom of the dot-com industry in the late 90s, the number has gone overboard. The numbers don't mean anything, because I feel that everyone, a generation's opinion about their personal problems is not so isolated. It's a common problem of every generation, in every nation, in every part of the world. It is how we interpret. We feel that now that we are here in America, we cannot do it. But the restriction is because we feel that we are not getting where we want, because there's a discrimination. The parents still think that because they had a job as a doctor or an engineer when they came here, the child would be guaranteed security. But it's encouraging to see that on MTV, on CNN, on other medias, Newsweek, etc., how many of our younger generation in film, etc., they are making their mark. So there's still hope. I don't think that we should feel so disheartened that we are not getting anywhere. By next 10 years, it is expected that 1/3 of the population will be immigrants. There are 15% students at my campus of Asian origin. Out of that, 80% make up to the dean's list. I think what we should focus on is that we are here. We are here to stay. We should establish scholarship programs to encourage our students to pursue their dreams. In order to do that, we have to make sure that instead of drawing room fashionable conversation, we do something and put all our efforts together to unify. Thank you.
Thank you, Niloufar, for arriving and participating despite your throat, and thank you for your very poignant personal narrative. Thank you for sharing that with us. And after having all the panelists speak, it just leaves me convinced that I think we need an entire conference dedicated to South Asian youth at some point, so we can hear more of their perspectives. So, but I do want to, I think what we've done is highlighted some issues that South Asian youth are currently facing and grappling with and continue to do so. And we wanted to really open it out for discussions and questions and comments, because I know, as I said earlier, I'm sure a lot of you find these stories familiar and close to heart. So we'll open it for comments and questions now.
I'm really tall, so I usually feel self-conscious about standing up. Every one of the presenters has touched to some degree on the price of difference, and that's laudable. But I'm looking at the panel and just thinking back to the people who spoke before you. My question is the discourse on Asian Americans usually significantly shaped by scholars from Bangladesh, India, or Pakistan?
I'm not sure I understood your question. Could you just repeat that?
The people who presented so far, have either been from Bangladesh?
You mean all the panels or just...
Right.
Okay.
And other panels as well. Okay. So my question is the discourse on Asian Americans usually significantly shaped by people from those three countries or not?
Does anybody want to take that?
Incidentally, we had discussed about it prior to when we were arranging, since it was at quite a short notice. And we do feel that we have to involve the different communities. But as you can see, this is a feeler to find what are the aspects that we would like to discuss in future. And it would be, I suppose, we have discussed earlier behind that it would be interesting to get speakers and individuals from different Asian communities to participate and find what are the common factors.
Thank you. I think Dr. Saran has...
India. These are different countries now, but we represent pretty much same heritage, background, and culture. So there is a common thread, you know, no matter, you know, who the speaker is, where he or she is coming from.
Would it be different if we had people from China as well and
Thailand? Sure, of course, yeah. I mean, yes, there would be some difference, but that's not...
My concern.
Sure, yeah.
Yes, slightly.
Well, let me just talk a little bit about it, because it's a whole different issue. I'm not sure if it's what you're getting at, but there's this notion of Asian American and where do South Asians fit within Asian American? Because, you know, in terms of the entire sort of Asian American universe, and most people associate that with East Asians, right? So South Asians aren't always under that umbrella, although in terms of campus organizing and student organizations, they are. And there's a movement... you know, what is South Asian or Asian Americans but pan-ethnicity? And pan-ethnicity is a strategy used by minorities in order to band together for some purpose, right? So there is probably more of a movement for South Asians to get under the Asian American umbrella to organize and to have more of a voice. So I'm not sure if you're making that distinction or you're talking about the absence of the other South Asian countries on this panel.
Okay. Yes,
but I think this is a very basic question we all confronted. I myself, I was born in China, in Qingdao, the beer, you know, and then went to Taiwan. When I was 15 years old, I went to Taiwan. When I was 30 years old, I came to America. When I was 45 years old, I said, "Wow, 16 years in America. I'm American? No, I'm a Chinese, still Chinese." But as also another question, I have several layers. Your question, several layers. Another layer. I was confused. When I came here, I talked to my wife. I said, "Don't go to China. It's dirty. Don't go. Read English. Don't study Chinese." Until I met a elderly Chinese poet, you know, and she said, share with you. She said, "If you're not good Chinese, you can never be a good American." Oh, down on me. Because everybody, in the beginning, wanted to be a good American. But you're not good Chinese, how can you be good American? So now, because the Hillary Clinton's to raise a child, so therefore, gradually, I think no more Chinese, you know, gradually less Chinese, less Indian, less, more Asian, more universal, global village. I think this is a win because the technology, communication, putting us together faster and faster. We are getting less identity. But at home, we're still Chinese food, Indian food, Pakistani food. But in the public, we have to accommodate ourselves with the whole community. Two people, I always hate, two Chinese, three Chinese, they're talking Chinese. When they're non-Chinese speaking, they're still talking Chinese. That's discrimination. So always publicly, you always use English, and you go to China and always still, why three Chinese, four Chinese talking English? Well, they cannot communicate in Chinese. They have to communicate in English. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll take a couple more questions, yes?
Actually, I really want to answer this question that the South Asian, where that South Asian word came from. Actually, if you see like 15 years ago, there was no South Asian word. There was mostly people say Asian. When you say Asian in American culture or American people, they think like Chinese people, Asian, because we were like nowhere in Asia. So that's how 15 years ago, this word came from California. And I would say like from 10 years, it's surrounded all over in America. And now there is a South Asian, because if you see, before we used to call Indian. So there was some group like Pakistani or Bangladeshi, they say, no, we are not Indian. We are Bangladeshi, we are Pakistani. So that's how the South Asian word is started, that let's come together like Latino. So that's how South Asian word is started, that we are South Asian, we are not Chinese, that's why.
I think there was a realization that Asia is such a diverse region, and there's so much diversity in terms of languages and cultures and values and behaviors and all of that between all the countries in Asia, which included, you know, India and Pakistan and China and Japan. So in order to kind of make subgroups, that's how South Asia emerged as one region, and that's what is represented here. Yes.
We could go back further with this business about terms. First, it was Hindu at the beginning of the 20th century. Then it was East Indian.
Right.
Then we've come to South Asian. A lot of you touched on the question of change, the changing knowledge of mutual knowledge of Americans who are not from South Asia about South Asians and South Asians about the world that they are growing into. I wondered whether you thought that Americans, who seem to me living 5 years in South Asia, are incredibly provincial, whether Americans are learning more, getting more understanding of South Asia, of Muslims from South Asia, as well as Muslims in general, and of South Asian Americans.
Samina?
Yeah. Well, I think that especially in the classroom, this is, and especially through interdisciplinary curriculum, I mean, this is a great place for Americans to, and South Asian Americans and South Asian students, and of course, you know, I mean, just everybody to be able to, you know, to really explore the diversity, the issues, you know, a lot of these kinds of issues that are really important. But it has to, you know, it has to happen when there's full representation.
Mm-hmm. Let me address another part of that, and I'm not sure if this is what you're talking about, but there's this great book out by Alba and Nee called Remaking the Mainstream. And the idea is that it's not just that immigrants are shaped by the mainstream, but especially, you know, even in terms of the post-1965 immigrants, but the immigrants themselves change what the mainstream is, right? So I think of even, you know, people who are 10, 15 years younger than me, growing up in a mainstream that's different from the one that I was acculturated in, right? The things that were considered unknown or exotic about South Asian culture is much more familiar. So I think for young people today, there's this different sense of who they are, right? It's cool to be ethnic now. But there are all kinds of problems around that. But in a sense, there's a different sort of flavor to growing up Indian or South Asian now than it was a generation ago. I don't know if that addresses.
We'll just take one. We have to break for lunch, so one comment, yes, or question.
I just wanted to ask really quickly if you think that, particularly Rifat and Samina, certainly the others can comment on it, but I wanted to ask if you think that the biggest challenges for youth, now first generation particularly, is communicating with their parents. How much of an impact that is.
Exactly. Can I actually? Okay, go ahead. That is a very, very big problem in my family. Considering I kind of was turned off to speaking Gujarati to begin with, my grandmother lives with us. She has a hard time understanding me, unfortunately. And same with my cousins because of my American accent, and my parents as well. They tend to baby me with the American words, and they have a mixture of Gujarati, American, English kind of thing, but then sometimes they slip into Gujarati all the time, and they talk over my head at times, and then they translate, even though some of the times I know exactly what they're saying. So there's a very big issue with communication.
I'm sorry, I have to kind of call it a day here. I know there are many more questions, and many more of you have things that you would love to comment on and talk about. And again, feel free to talk to the panelists over lunch and over the breaks. But I do appreciate your questions. They're all very valuable questions. I want to thank the panelists for being here today.